panel today consists of Dr. Sarah Hummel from Desert Trails Veterinary Clinic in Winnemucca, Joe Gillespie from Boehringer Ingelheim in McCook, Nebraska, and Lyle Whitaker from Lahontan Valley Veterinary Clinic in Fallon. And so the way that we will operate here this morning is the vet panel. Each member of the vet panel will get 10, 15 minutes or so for their featured topic. Okay, next, Dr. Whitaker from Fallon, I'll turn it over to you and I'll stand aside and let you go.
Okay, thank you.
Perfect.
All righty. Okay, like you said, I'm Dr. Lyle Whitaker. I'm from Lahontan Valley Vet Clinic here in Fallon. They asked us to speak and they didn't really give us a topic, which is sometimes kind of hard to do. So I was talking with Dr. Hummel and she kind of said, well, what's the most common question that you get from people? And honestly, the most common question I think I get from people is, you know, what should I be vaccinating my animals for, and what should I use, and when should I do it? That's not the easiest topic, and I'm kind of regretting picking it because there's so many things that are involved in that I spent a lot of time preparing this, and I hope that comes across and this is somewhat organized, because I get asked that question all the time. And I remember even in vet school, we sat down and asked one of our professors, like, can you make us a vaccine protocol? And he's like, well, yeah, but it depends, and depends on this and depends on that. We never got a straight answer. So I'm hoping that I can clarify some things and answer some of the most common questions that I get. There's been a lot of talk all over the news everywhere over the last couple of years about what a vaccine is. And in effect, a vaccine is basically either a modified organism, a virus or a bacteria, protozoa, or a piece of that organism that vaccine companies alter a little bit. So that way the body can recognize that as foreign without actually causing a clinical disease. So what that does is it enables our immune system or the animal's immune system to recognize that in the future and be able to fight it off before they get really severely sick. Like Dr. Gillespie said before, you know, hopefully you can prevent that before they need to be given antibiotics. That's kind of the goal with vaccines, is to prevent clinical disease. They don't prevent infection, but they can prevent, you know, severe clinical disease. And that's something that's important to remember, is that sometimes even if a vaccine isn't 100% effective, if you spread that out over the course of your whole herd or a feedlot or something like that, it can decrease the damaging effects of the disease by quite a bit, even if you do still see some mild disease. There's different manufacturers of vaccines. There's Zoetis, Boehringer Ingelheim, Elanco, Merck. Those are kind of four of the biggest ones. There's a couple other ones, but when you go looking for vaccines, that's going to be your biggest companies that you're going to find. You often hear the terms five-way, seven-way, eight-way, you know, and people get confused about those. Basically, what those mean is it's kind of a slang term for how many organisms are covered in a single vaccine. So a five-way vaccine doesn't necessarily mean it's a specific type of vaccine, and the eight-way vaccine doesn't necessarily categorize it into a certain vaccine, but it's pretty common to hear those types of things. I'm sure everybody's familiar with how to give a shot. In general, you could give a shot with a subcutaneous. If it's labeled for subcutaneous, you're going to want to use a shorter needle, like an inch. If it's IM, you're going to want to go at a more direct angle and give it an inch and a half. There's some newer vaccines that are intranasal on the market. Those will come with a specific attachment to actually go into the nostril of the calf or the cow. And then there's some oral vaccines that are a little bit more rare, but they are out there, and that's pretty self-explanatory how to give those. The biggest types of vaccines, there's modified live vaccines and inactivated vaccines. And then there's a few other ones that probably don't need to be worried about, you know, some more live ones, like the foothill abortion vaccines, a little bit different. Dr. Gogochia talked a little bit about that. And those have to be handled a little bit differently. But the biggest vaccines that you're going to be able to buy from a rep or at the feed store or anything like that are modified live and inactivated vaccines. A modified live vaccine contains a small amount of virus that has been altered, so it doesn't cause clinical disease. That virus or bacteria can still replicate in the animal and cause a really controlled infection. But because it's altered, it doesn't cause clinical disease. Some of the advantages to modified lives are they elicit a pretty strong and long-lasting immune response. Some of them don't require a booster, and they're less likely to cause allergic reactions. Some of the disadvantages are that you got to mix them. I'm sure everybody's familiar with that, where you have the powder and you mix it with the dilutant. And then those you need to use pretty quick and keep them cool. The biggest disadvantage to modified live vaccines, and a lot of people are familiar with this, is that they can cause abortions of cows. Even if you're giving them to calves that are nursing, that can seroconvert and cause an abortion in the cow. So I kind of recommend to people, and this isn't set in stone, but if you have to mix up a vaccine, ask yourself if you can be giving that to nursing calves or a pregnant cow. And if you have any questions, always just call your vet and ask them, and we can answer that question for you really quick. Killed or inactivated vaccines, they've been kind of altered so that they produce a stronger immune response, but they do not replicate like modified live vaccines do. They're safe to use in pregnant cows, and some of the advantages that they have are, you know, you don't run the risk of spreading disease between animals. You don't have to mix it up, and there's lower risk of abortion. Some of the disadvantages are there's usually a booster dose required for it to be effective. The immunity is usually not as strong or as long lasting, and it has a slower onset of immunity. And some of them can cause anaphylactic reactions, which is another reason, like Dr. Hummel talked about, it's a good idea to maybe talk to your vet and see if you can get some epinephrine if needed. They can also be a little bit more expensive. So this is the question that I get asked all the time, you know, when and what should I vaccinate with? And my answer is always, it depends. You know, every operation is different. Everybody has different facilities. Everybody calves at different intervals. Some people preg check their cows. Some people don't. Some people, you know, there's a million different things. And I kind of, as I was preparing this presentation, I come from more of a dairy background. I grew up on a dairy here in Fallon. We still dairy. I spend every day preg checking cows on dairies and spending time with dairies. So it's a little different on a dairy because your animals are confined and you have access to them regularly. So when a vaccine company comes out with a different vaccine, it's usually not that big of a deal to incorporate that into a dairy situation, where a vet or a beef operation can be quite a bit harder, because there's some operations, we know this, that you turn your cows out and you see them one time a year, and that's the only chance you get to do much with them. But no matter what your situation is, there's always some vaccine protocol that you can figure out with your vet. So what I recommend to most people that ask this question is, start by defining, you know, when are you preg checking? When are you weaning? When are you gathering? When are you doing all your major events with your cows? And then try and work with that schedule to fill in when you're going to do your vaccinations. And that's a good place to start. So I tell people that, and they ask me again, yeah, but what should I do? So I thought about that as I was preparing this presentation, and what I did is I kind of combined this. I basically went through and categorized all the different vaccines, and we'll go through that here in a minute. And I basically made a general, you know, this is a good idea where you can start with. Now, this is probably a little more involved than what most people want to get, you know, how many times you have to catch your cows and run them through a chute and give them shots, but take what you can from this and tailor it with your veterinarian on in each individual basis based on your specific situation. So people ask me this, you know, you go and you look at vaccines and you hear all these different words like pyramid and enforce and pre-response and five-way and eight-way, and you hear all these different things, and maybe you don't know what that is. So basically, with your general vaccines, there's five main categories of vaccines. You know, your first one's going to be your clostridial vaccines, and these are your eight ways. So when you look on the bottle, and it says clostridium, there's a whole bunch of different ones. Those are what are generally referred to as your seven-way or eight-way vaccines. Those are going to cover all your clostridial problems like black leg and red water. The next one is the respiratory and reproductive vaccines. The reason I lump these two together is because a lot of your respiratory problems also cause reproductive problems. So Dr. Gillespie talked a little bit about BRD, your bovine respiratory disease complex. Your main pathogens that cause those are IBR, BRSV, PA3, Pasteurella, Mannheimia, and then these five-way vaccines, as they're referred to a lot of times, also include BVD. And BVD is definitely something that you want to watch out for. You don't want to get that into your herd. And if you've ever heard of persistently infected calves, it can be a big problem. So when you hear the word five-way, and a lot of times these are modified live vaccines that you have to mix, that's what you're trying to protect against. You know, your bovine respiratory disease complex and BVD. Whatever you want to call it, category is reproductive. And that's going to be what you're going to give your cows before they're getting bred to prevent abortions. And that's going to include things like leptospirosis, vibriosis or campylobacter, and then as well, brucellosis, which obviously has to be given by the vet. And there's a few other vaccines that are a lot more common in the dairy industry that are given to the mother cows to prevent scours in the calves. And those are going to be your digestive vaccines that include things like rotavirus, coronavirus, E. coli, and salmonella. Then there's a whole bunch of other vaccines. I mean, we can't possibly cover a vaccine and everything about it in 10 to 15 minutes, but you know, you're going to have your anaplasma vaccines, pink eye, which if you hear the word Moroxella bovis, that's going to be a pink eye vaccine. So a lot of times if you see Moroxella combined with another vaccine, that's going to help cover some instances of pink eye, and then warts, you know, more for your, a lot of times in bulls, you'll vaccinate for that. Okay, so like I said, when you go to the feed store, there's a whole bunch of different manufacturers, a whole bunch of different brand names, and they can get kind of confusing. So I kind of tried to break it down a little bit. I don't think I did the best job. And I'm not saying that, you know, I'm totally supporting or endorsing one over the other. I just kind of went through and saw what everybody had and tried to put it in a spot by keeping it all under these categories. You know, when you go to Zoetis, I won't go through all these, but if you look at those main vaccine categories, these are the names here on the right for each individual category. Same with Boehringer Ingelheim. You know, your clostridial disease are going to be Alpha, Barvac, Caliber. Respiratory and reproductive vaccines are Triangle, Express. I can't see the rest of my screen, but Pyramid, Pre-Sponse, things like that. So Zoetis, Boehringer Ingelheim, Merck, Elanco. You know, each one of these companies are going to produce basically all of your vaccines that are going to cover all of the major problems in cattle that we have vaccines for. Now, each individual company also has a different kind of combination. They're generally the same, but each company will have a different combination based on a few different things. And that's when you have to work with your veterinarian specifically to make sure that you're covering all your bases with each of your vaccines that you're given. So the next part of my presentation will basically break it down, you know, each individual event, you know, when are you going to give vaccines and what vaccines you're going to give. You know, like I said, this is pretty in-depth and it may not be feasible for a lot of people, but it's something to go off of. Dr. Gillespie talked about the importance of colostrum. You know, this is absolutely critical, especially in a dairy, because dairy calves will not get up and nurse. So you got to get those calves in and you got to feed them colostrum. And if you don't, well over half of them are just going to die. No amount of antibiotics or anything you can do is going to save them. And the reason for that is because this is a generalization, but calves basically don't have an immune system when they're born. You know, they get all their immune system, not technically, but pretty much from their mother. So in order for their mother to give good colostrum, their mothers need to be immunized too. And that's part of the reason why it's important to immunize the cows, is so that when they're making the colostrum for the calves, they pass on good immunity to their babies. But because of this, it also makes, you know, vaccinating young calves kind of hard. It would be easy to run out and give a bunch of shots to a brand new calf because they don't move very much. You don't got to run through a chute and you can grab them easy. But doesn't necessarily work that way because the antibodies from the mother will interfere with the immune stimulation from the baby. There's a few products on the market that you can give oral vaccines to calves. It's tough to get these on a beef operation soon enough. So usually it's better just to plan on vaccinating the mothers. And then, like I talked about earlier, there's a few intranasal vaccines you can give calves that are against some respiratory diseases that are safe to use in nursing calves and pregnant cows. And you can give those as early as a day old. So that's something to think about if you have a lot of respiratory problems in your calves. Continuing on the calf's life from 3 months to weaning, you know, it's a good idea to get some immunity before they go through a stressful event like weaning and they end up in a feedlot or something like that. So 2 to 3 weeks before weaning, you're going to want to give them a clostridial vaccine or an eight-way, a respiratory and reproductive vaccine, which will cover your respiratory problems and BVD. And then obviously some point after 4 months, you're going to want to give brucellosis and then pink eye if there's problems with that, which I've seen more and more issues, especially in the dairy world. And that always spills over into the beef world with pink eye. And there's a couple different types you can go. You can make your own vaccine based on your own herd, or you can have an already manufactured one from one of the many companies that produce that. Now, again, this is what's hard for some people is to give a shot before weaning a shot for other, but it's an idea. These will be a booster. You know, if you gave those vaccines before weaning, then they would have good immunity going into weaning and then boost that immunity with another clostridial and respiratory and reproductive vaccine after weaning. Before you turn the bulls out for your cows and heifers, it's a good idea to give a respiratory and a reproductive vaccine again. You know, that's going to be your five-way containing BVD and IBR. For your cows, this will be a booster. Your heifers will be a booster. But it's also good at this time to give a reproductive vaccine covering vibriosis and leptospirosis in your pre-breeding animals. For cows, pregnant cows, it's getting a little bit harder because it starts limiting the vaccines that are safe and effective. But it's a good idea to boost again with a clostridial to give another respiratory if you're going to have issues with that, mainly for the calves. But you're going to want to, you know, make sure you read the label and make sure it's labeled safe for pregnant cows. And to be on the safe side, make sure those cows have been vaccinated with one of those respiratory vaccines before. A reproductive lepto booster. And then this digestive is where you would give a scour vaccine. Ideally, you'd give two doses, which is, I know, again, is very hard. But this is more for the calf to boost the colostrum immunity. And then that kind of covers all of it. So your bulls, you know, they're pretty easy to give just annual booster vaccines to cover respiratory and reproductive problems. If you have wart problems in your bulls, you can give wart vaccines. There's a few other things. Trick vaccines, which aren't always the most effective. It's usually better just to test, but is an option there. So I think that's pretty much all I have. Pretty quick. Hopefully it kind of broke it down a little bit for you guys so you could see basically what I want to get across was there's the main categories of vaccines that you want to keep stuff that you want to keep straight and cover your bases with those. That's it.